She's faced the hardest times you could imagine. And many times her eyes fought back the tears. And when her youthful world was about to fall in, each time her slender shoulders bore the weight of all her fears, and a sorrow no one hears still rings in midnight silence in her ears. Let her cry. She's a
This is the Chapters Wrap Wednesday Night Live, and we're so blessed to have Bronson Arroyo join us in a few minutes. He was just inducted into the Cincinnati Reds Hall of Fame, yes, with the Big Red Machine. Congratulations to Bronson Arroyo. He's played with Pittsburgh. He's played with the Boston Red Sox. He's played, obviously, with the Cincinnati Reds and the Arizona Diamondbacks, and he's a great guy. He gives back to his community in whatever community he's in. And he obviously is an outstanding baseball player, and he's a great community person. And to see that unfold in Cincinnati with all those legends behind him was surely a sight to see. So we're going to get to Bronson in a few minutes, but let's go over some news here. First of all, it's my mom's birthday. She passed away many years ago. And as a psychologist, I wouldn't be doing nothing, if it wasn't for my mom. She dealt with a major mental illness and MS. So she wasn't really able to care for me and my younger brother all the time, but she gave everything she had as a woman back in the 70s and the late 60s. And I miss her very, very much. And all the work that I've done in my career is solely because of what God's given me, but also what my mom's taught me to learn compassion. So her name is Rosalind Vaccaro. And this song that you heard earlier, thanks to Anna, she put that together, is Wildflower by Skylark. They were one-hit wonder back in the 70s, but if you listen to those lyrics, just like if you listen to any of Bronson Arroyo's lyrics, they're meaningful. So, Mom, I love you. Till we meet again in heaven, and thank you so very much for everything that you've done. It's helped me create this whole Chapters Network. Chapters Community Support Services is a nonprofit organization based with networking, collaboration, support, and providing a platform for other challenged people or families or nonprofits or agencies that need that voice, need to be heard, or need to be seen. I believe you can help people, but if you put a microphone or a camera in front of somebody, the ability to help more is greater. So it's strength in numbers. So if you want to contact us, chaptersnetwork.org. I'm so thankful for everybody behind the scenes. And tonight it's Anna, who's our lead graphics person, but also our lead engineer. Just so you guys know, 80% of our staff, our interns and volunteers and paid staff have some sort of disability or challenge. So basically it's providing a platform for others, but also behind the scenes, it's helping each person that's part of Chapters. I'm also the producer of Bat Boy. Bat Boy is coming around with Ray Negron's story, 50 years in baseball. Since 1973, Ray Negron has been with the New York Yankees, and he has a play called Bat Boy Returns, which we've been doing in the last couple of years, and all the proceeds go to nonprofit organizations or programs or families in need. We have two shows next week, one for the Boys and Girls Club of Mount Vernon here in New York. That's July 24th. And then we're going to hightail it down to Baltimore, Maryland at the Babe Ruth Museum on July 28th, Friday. And the Yankees are in town against the Baltimore Orioles. So Ray Negron's story is the ultimate story of second chances. So you want to catch that play. If you can't catch those, we'll be announcing other play times, show times in the near future. So stay with us regarding all that. My good friend Debbie Mayfort is the executive director to the Olive Osman Hearing Fund here in New York. She's doing a great event at Citi Field on July 30th. What she does is provide funds for families and individuals that are in need of hearing aids but can't afford them. On the average, hearing aids cost about $8,000 to $12,000, and insurances do not cover them at this point. So Debbie has made a full court press on getting hearing aids to those families in need. And with the support of the Osman family, yes, the Osman family, Justin Osman, together they're teaming up to get those hearing aids in the proper hands of so many. Today, we were able to give out 50 free tickets to the Staten Island Ferry Hawks game to children in foster care programs in the tri-state area. So 50 kids went to Staten Island today to see the Ferry Hawks play. And I want to thank everybody over there, Ray, for at Staten Island Ferry Hawks for providing tickets and offering them for me to give them to these foster kids and families that are in great need. As a product of the foster care system, it's my goal to continue to support families and individuals that are going through the system. And if you want, if you're thinking about being a foster parent, go for it. We need it. The kids need it. And this is a time in life where it's challenging for all of us. So think about becoming a foster parent. Those kids really need you. Recently, Elise Finch, who was a meteorologist here in New York, passed away. She did a lot of great work for the Boys and Girls Club in Mount Vernon. She was a meteorologist here on CBS, and she was a community leader. She was honored by the Boys and Girls Club a couple of years back. Unfortunately, she suddenly passed away at 51 years old. Our thoughts and prayers go out to the Finch family. And here's a little snippet of a recent newscast offering the information that Ms. Finch passed away.
Tonight, it is with profound sadness that we want to share the news of the passing of our beloved Elise Finch. Elise has been a friend and a team member at WCBS for 16 years. First as our weekend meteorologist with Steve and me, and most recently in the mornings. Elise was a gifted and consummate professional who took great care with her work. She was also a wonderful ambassador in the community, including her hometown of Mount Vernon. But above all, Elise was a fiercely loving and devoted mother to Grace and a wife to Greg, who we join in grieving this tremendous loss. There was no one like her. We're all going to miss her very much, and we'll be right back.
Talk about people that pass on. I really love people that use their profession, their talent, their skills set to do the things that they do, but also to give back in the community, because it's all about giving back. And when we talk to Bronson, he's one of those people, but Elise was one of those people too. That's why the Boys and Girls Club of Mount Vernon honored her a few years back. Again, our thoughts and prayers go out to the entire Finch family, and may Elise rest in eternal peace forever and ever. And it's just sad, sad news. The other day, we have a young man that's part of our network. He does a show, Never Let Up. And he's a young man which has overcome a lot of challenges in life. He's put out a song called Blessed. There's Nate Jeezy right there. And he had an open mic the other night. Check this out, guys. On the YouTube channel, he has 1.1 million views of this song, Blessed. And it keeps moving up the ranks there. And he put a caricature of me and him together on the album cover. So Nate, Jeezy, God bless you, man, and your family that supports you. It's such a wonderful thing that you're doing, and keep doing what you're doing, because you're giving other people an opportunity to see things differently in life. And you go out there and do your thing. You've overcome your challenges, and you're teaching others along the way. So without further ado, before I bring Bronson on, I had to put this on because I forgot yesterday was July 18th. And if you're a Yankee fan or a David Cone fan or the baseball fan, July 18th, a couple years back, was a big day at Yankee Stadium. Let's check out this little video and then bring on our special guest, Squeegee, because he was a big part of it.
Popped up and playable. Gracious. A perfect save by David Cone.
Was July 18th. There's Squeegee and David Cone. Squeegee, are you there?
I'm here. Hi, Steve. Hi, Chapters Rap.
Yeah, how you doing? Now, when July 18th rolls around every year, you must get the goosebumps and think, did this really happen? Or, I mean, are you imagining things? What a great baseball moment.
Yeah, Steve. Every year, yesterday, July 18th, it just brings back so many memories, and it reminds me I'm getting a year older every year. You know, just going back and, you know, being with David, and we always, when we link up, we talk about it, you know, we get a chuckle out of it now because, you know, looking back at it, you know, I was with no catching gear in the Valsey Yankee Stadium during that 33-minute rain delay, and he needed someone to warm him up, and he chose me, and he was skipping him off the roof, off the pipes. In the bowels of the Yankee Stadium, the old Yankee Stadium. And we found another unique way to go out in front of the Yankee dugout and keep warming up. And that's the only warming up he did before play resumed again. And I guess the stars were aligned and everybody made great plays. And here we are today, 24 years later, talking about the historical immortality of David Cone, his perfect game.
24 years ago. Holy cow. That is baseball history. And Domingo Germán just pitched a perfect game. So now there's a little club going on. And that day wasn't just David Cone's perfect game. It was Yogi Berra day and Don Larson was in the house.
That's right. 1956, reenacting the ceremonial first pitch of the 1956 World Series perfect game between Don Larson and Yogi Berra. And they passed down the mojo to David that day, and unique, he threw 88 pitches. Go for Yogi, number 8. And, you know, David supports Yogi Berra, the Yogi Berra Museum, and he's a historian. And you already know, Steve, the Yankee tradition and history. Domingo Germán just joined a unique club, and his name starts with a D. So I guess if you're in the future and your name starts with a D, you might throw a perfect game.
Well, you know what? We have a really special guest coming up, and I know you briefly touched base with him when we did our Bat Boys show in Florida, because this guy performed for us, but you guys had a chat, and you went up to him and said, you owe me money or something? I don't know what was going on with that. What are you talking about?
Bronson Arroyo, great guy. Whoever would have thought Red Sox and Yankees can't get along? I went up to him, and I said, hey, Bronson, nice to meet you, and I thought he would get a chuckle out of it. I said, hey, man, you know Ramiro Mendoza? He's the godfather of my second born. He's like, yeah, I had him on the phone, and they spoke briefly. And then I went up to him, and I said, hey, Bronson, man, you owe me some money. You cost me my World Series share and everybody else when you guys reversed the curse in 2004 and beat us. And he got a chuckle out of it. He's like, oh, yeah, the World Series bonus that we all get. And, you know, it was just great talking to him. They deserved it. They were the better team that year. And it was just great to talk to Bronson, and he's a great guy, down to earth, and I love what he does for the kids.
Well, you know what? We're going to put him on the air right now so you can ask for your money directly. Bronson, are you there, sir? Bronson, are you hearing this, Bronson?
I'm hearing it, but trust me, whatever money I stole from him in 04, they stole some from me in 03. So we're
that.
Hey, brother, how you doing, Bronson, man? Good to see you again, brother.
Yeah, you too, man. Yeah, we had a great night down in Florida, and we got to chat. And, you know, that's what you find out when you leave the game is that, you know, personality always wins out. It doesn't really matter what team you play with. You know, in a lot of ways, the good guys in the clubhouse were always the good guys. And the guys that were jerks were always jerks, right? And Squeegee can tell you that. And, you know, I enjoy mixing it up with all kinds of different people. And we definitely had a good time that night.
Yeah, very pleasure seeing you play the guitar, brother. You had me jamming. You had the whole crowd going. And, you know, it's just a blessing to see you off the field and what you do for communities and where you live and around the world, brother, man. And we need more people like you and David Cone, you know, to step up and keep helping our urban communities and kids all around the world.
Nice, man. Yeah, I was watching today, Dave. I just saw the perfect little documentary that on David Cone's Perfect Game Today, and it's like it's amazing how fast the years go by for one, but also just to see, you know, so many guys that you loved in early on in my career, you know, that were kind of tailing off at the end. Like David was already kind of near the end of his career by the time I got to the big leagues, but to see some of those guys and then to look up their numbers and to like compare them to guys to today or myself. And just to see what David Cone should be in the Hall of Fame. I mean, you look up at his numbers, it's unbelievable. He's got like a 62 WAR, almost won 200 games and only lost like 120. I mean, great, great career.
A great career. Before we get into, you had a great weekend. And Squeegee, do you know that Bronson was just inducted into the Cincinnati Reds Hall of Fame this past weekend? So I think we lost Squeegee there. But Bronson, when we go back to 04, did your teammates, you down 3-0 to the Yankees. Did you think you were coming back, or did you have a little seed of hope built in you? Obviously, the momentum built, and you beat the Yankees and won the World Series against the Cardinals. But was there a moment that you guys all doubted yourself, or not really?
No, I mean, I think, you know, you go into a playoff series hoping that you can kind of build on what you've done all season long. But in a short series of seven games, I mean, anything could really happen unless you're just completely dominant over the other team. And, you know, in that Yankee Red Sox rivalry, it always felt like you never knew who was going to win. I mean, we played 19 times a year. It was never where they beat us, you know, 12 out of 19. I mean, it was usually neck and neck, you know, back and forth. And so, you know, you get down 3-0, you lose the year before. I mean, you really are starting to dwindle hope. But as a ball player, you come to the park every day, and all you could do is just kind of, you know, lace up your spikes and get after it and see what happens. Because we all know that momentum in sports can kind of shift. And once we won that first one, then it felt like we had something to kind of cling to. And then once you win the second one, it almost felt like we had tied the series when we were still down 3-2 going back to Yankee Stadium. And so, you know, you need a little bit of luck. Sometimes you need a little bit of hope. But, you know, they could have went either way. If you watch that back, I mean, just the bouncing of the ball one way or the other in a couple instances, we could have been swept in that series and we wouldn't be talking about, you know, the greatest comeback in sports.
It was a great, great moment. And before we get into the Cincinnati stuff, and which is huge, this show is not a sports show. It's partially sports, but it's a more community-based show. And when we met each other in Florida, you were asked to perform for a veterans group called Heat, which you did. You performed, and all night you didn't accept any money to support you and anything. You gave back to the veterans, and we have Gus, who's in charge of Heat, on the line. He just wanted to share his thanks and gratitude for you putting out that night. Gus, are you there?
I'm here. How are you? Congratulations, Bronson.
Thanks. I appreciate it.
Yep. And before I forget, happy birthday to your mother in heaven.
Thank you, Gus. And talk about Heat real quick, what Heat does and how Bronson helped you that night.
Oh, he's still helping me. I'll tell you about that in a minute, but the Veterans Heat Factory is an organization, nonprofit organization, for veterans and first responders suffering with PTSD. We do one-on-one therapy. We do group therapy. Basically, what we do is we provide purpose for veterans that has lost everything and We've been very successful, and I think we're up to about 124 veterans we've helped out so far. And I want to thank Bronson so many times because, you know what, I kind of use you a lot as a segue into talking to people here in Hernando County, which you're putting on, put us up on the map, and Hernando High School. I'm on the school board there, so I use you a lot to bring into the conversation about the Heat by just saying, you know who I spoke to? And then they want to know why that happened, and I go right into the Heat. So what you did there has been carrying on, and I can't thank you enough.
Well, I appreciate it. You know, obviously being from Hernando County, Brooksville's a small town, and, you know, there's obviously all kinds of good causes all over the country that, you know, people just need help. I mean, life is hard. It's the way it is. And, you know, as long as I'm feeling healthy and feel like I can give back, it's nice to get out in the community and do some things when we get an opportunity. So I'm thankful that, you know, we got to move the needle at least slightly for you guys.
A little more than slightly. You're a beautiful soul. I appreciate you very much.
Yeah, well, Gus does amazing work for the veterans, and we've gotten involved through our show and the different things that we've done. And I see the veterans that need that platform, that need that support, because sometimes it's not out there. You have to really help the situation or advocate or empower or push people along, like on a governmental level. Mm-hmm. And what Gus does is bring communities together and these veterans hope. So that night we needed somebody to perform, and you stepped up, my man, Bronson. I really appreciate that because I know the challenges that Gus has day to day, financial, and what you did help them. And like he said, put them on the map.
Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Gus. How can people contact Heat? How can they get a hold of you?
Well, the website is theveteransheatfactory.com. You can reach me at 352-650-1512.
Gus, thank you for spending a few minutes, and I'm sure we'll be seeing each other down the road real soon.
Thank you so much to both of you. I appreciate you so much.
All right, guys. Have a good one.
God bless. We have another person that's going to hop on, and then we'll get to that Cincinnati special weekend that you had. Tina, the Florida Bolts is part of the girls' baseball team, and she is so proactive and passionate about getting girls on the baseball field, not playing with the boys, not playing with softball, but getting to play baseball. And Tina, are you there?
I am here. Nice to hear you, Steve.
Thank you, Tina. And thank you for all the wonderful things that you do and the support that you give to those girls and the inspiration you give to so many people as well. You got Bronson on the line, and I saw before he got inducted into the Cincinnati Hall of Fame, Cincinnati Red Hall of Fame, he was with you guys, the Floral Bolts. Tina, how did that come about?
It was pretty unbelievable, I'll tell you that. My girls were just ecstatic. They just could not believe it. You know, he kind of came up and just set up his little suitcase over there, the PJ, which I just thought was very, very cool. And nobody really knew that he played baseball until he pretty much got on the mic and, you know, the word got around. But he was just amazing. He took all the time in the world to take the time with these girls and take pictures and sign balls and photographs. And he actually took the time. And I mean, you could just see the eye contact with these girls. And they just really looked up to him and just couldn't believe that he was there. And he was actually going into the Reds Hall of Fame like the next day. It was almost like a dream for them. And to have his own chef come out and fix food for I don't know how many people, over 60 people, and it was just amazing. His food, his food that he brought in was just delicious. I mean, it was just delicious. It was just such a mellow time and such an important time for these girls. And I am just really, really, I'm just so proud of Bronson. I think that I think he is the way he is because he has conch blood in him, and his mom and dad are from the Keys. And, you know, I feel that myself, just from an island, you know, he's got to have that in his blood. And the kids, and just, you know, there's just not many people like you, and you just don't change anything about you, but you got to have some little problems because, you know, you got to stand on your path to play out.
That's right. Tina, we're having a little technical
problem. Can you guys still hear me there?
Yeah, yeah, we got a little technical problem. Bronson, what are your thoughts about what Tina's sharing and you giving up being there for those girls?
Yeah, you know, it worked out perfect. For one, you know, getting inducted into the Reds Hall of Fame was coming that weekend, and they were coming through, you know, 4 or 5 days ahead of time. It gave me a chance to have an opportunity to drive a couple of hours. You know, we're sitting outside of a park and just in a beautiful area with a lake outside. It was nice and sunny. It was just a really good time for the girls under a nice pavilion. And I set up my old equipment and, you know, I played, I don't know, 7 or 8 songs while everybody was eating. And we just delivered some beautiful barbecue for them. And then I got an opportunity to kind of answer some questions with the girls, you know, and it's just really nice to kind of to talk about baseball, especially with young people, because there's so many myths and so many kind of misnomers you hear over the years from different coaches. You know, if you can think back on when you played Little League Baseball and all of us played Little League Baseball, you're usually being taught by a guy who is probably a plumber or an electrician or a mailman. And a lot of times they don't know a lot about the game, but they're one of the few parents who are willing to give their time out there at the park. And so I like to give people, you know, a little bit of kind of a ground floor realization of what it's like to be a baseball player, what matters, what doesn't matter. And I got a real good chance that day to talk with the girls and answer some questions and make them feel like, you know, what they're doing on the field is important and how to go about it in a more efficient way.
At the end of the day, Bronson, when you're involved with these community efforts, I'm sure you did that every stop along the way. You played for the Pirates, played for the Red Sox, the Diamondbacks, and of course the Reds. Has it been important for you to connect with those communities in whatever way you felt was needed?
Yeah, you know, it started back in the minor leagues when I was in A-ball. I remember with the Pirates, my first time they ever sent me out in the community, and they said, you're going to go to this elementary school and you're going to sign some autographs for the kids. And when I got there, it was myself and a teammate named Dave Williams. They said, you know, here's the microphone and you're going to be up on the stage. We're going to bring the whole school into the auditorium and want you to explain the importance of education for about a half hour. And I was 19 years old and just absolutely, you know, terrified. And luckily I had somebody with me who was a college graduate and he could speak a little bit better than I did at the time. But you know, what you learn is being out in the community, people are just people. And it doesn't matter if you're a baseball player or where you come from. We all have sometimes the same insecurities, the same issues in life. And it's nice to just get out and help people and show your face and smile. And, you know, you can't do it all the time because it does suck a lot of energy from you. But I try to be present tense in those moments with people and feel like you're giving them the time of day and giving them something that they deserve in that moment.
And through your music, you do the same way. Tina, I know we're having technical problems. Any last final comments you want to say to Bronson?
He certainly did that for those girls. I mean, I just can't tell you how very, very, very proud that I am that he does this for everybody, not just for our girls. But, you know, he's got a great heart, and we just thank him from the bottom of our baseball hearts.
And how did the Florida Bolts do in the tournament that you had there?
Well, they won their first 2 games. So I told them it's because it's the first year they had a female in their dugout as a coach. Wow. But it's the first 2 games that they won. So these girls were ecstatic. I told them not to, you know, don't bow your heads. Be happy you got 2 games, and then we come back next year and you'll be stronger than you were this year. Wow. You know, and I could tell you one thing, when they say that there's no crying in baseball, that's a lie. Because at least in women's and girls baseball, there's a lot of crying going on.
Wow. Well, I know Tina and Brooke and all the other coaches, you put a lot of hard time into that because some of these girls are not around the corner from each other. So having practices is a challenge. So to compete on a level like that in a tournament, kudos to you and your staff.
Yes, and thank you. I mean, Brooke did an awesome job. She is an awesome organizer and a great, great manager. And, you know, thank you to the Rays that also helped provide the income that we could get 3 teams into this tournament.
Wow, wow. Well, Tina, thank you so very much. And I'm sure Bronson will be seeing you down the road real soon.
Yes, and congratulations, Bronson, in the Hall of Fame. We're very, very, very proud of you.
I appreciate it.
And you take care of that conch shell.
I will.
All right. You guys take care.
Thank you.
Bye.
This is a Chapters Wrap Wednesday Night Knife. We have Bronson Arroyo here, just inducted into the Cincinnati Reds Hall of Fame this past weekend. And we have a little clip of you doing an interview before we bring you back on. Let's check it out.
To be enshrined in a place with guys, you know, that I became friends with over the years playing here, like Joe Morgan and Pete Rose and Johnny Bench and all the great eight who have been so generous to come to this locker room so many times. You know, you had posters of those guys on your walls as a kid, or you watched them with your father on the couch, you know, and you just never think you're going to be anywhere near it. You don't think you'd ever be a part of it. Now to be part of a club that only has 91 members is, you know, for the oldest franchise in the game, it's something you just never think about that. I thought about making $100 million in baseball. I thought about winning 15 games. I thought about pitching 200 innings. I never once thought that my face would be carved on the side of a plaque that's going to sit on a wall for eternity next to guys like Joe Morgan. That's just something that is felt unreachable, unattainable. And, you know, for it to have happened here in Cincinnati, I married a hometown girl. It makes me feel like I'm at home. It makes me feel like I'm part of something. It makes me feel like I have a place in this game still. I'm thinking about it more in a way that it's more about Cincinnati and more about the team and about the future of this team, right? Because in a lot of ways, you know, as you see guys like Johnny Bench and Joe Morgan and then the next generation and the next generation, then you get to me, and it just keeps going. And what really should be beloved in this town is that we have Major League Baseball here for the last 150 years, right? And it doesn't really matter what human is standing inside that uniform, as long as the uniform is in Cincinnati Reds uniform. That is really where the most beautiful parts of this organization are. And, you know, I feel like it should be less about me in a way and more about the joy of the fact that we have this machine here that brings so much culture and so much memory for so many generations. You know, that's where I feel like it's at. And so I think when I'm standing on the field that night, it's going to feel more about that than just about myself personally.
So Bronson, standing on the night on that field, what did you feel?
You know, it's a surreal moment. You know, when you play baseball, you know, for a living, you think about surviving because it's very difficult. You think about staying healthy. You think about, you know, the next contract you're going to get. You think about winning World Series. You think about helping your teammates, but you never think about what will happen after it's all said and done. You know, you leave the game in that last day that you kind of pack your bag up for the last time and leave that stadium after 20 years of doing what you love. It feels like the end of a chapter of your life. It feels like leaving high school in a way. And it's very sad in some respects. And so you don't really think about any accolades after the fact. And to come back and be standing next to, like you said, the great eight, all the guys from the Big Red Machine, from Johnny Bench all the way down to Davey Concepcion, and Griffey Sr. and all the guys there, you know, it's just it doesn't feel right to be in my mid-40s and be having a bronze busk of my face on the side of a wall next to guys like Tom Seaver and Joe Nuxall. But you know, I earned that, and it's a beautiful moment, and I'm glad it happened here in Cincinnati. It's the oldest team in the game. They've got probably the best museum in sports outside of Cooperstown, and I think, it would have been very difficult to amass these types of numbers that have been traded a couple more times. And so I just kind of got lucky to stay here and be fortunate enough to play for 9 seasons to kind of amass enough numbers to get into that hall.
Now, is it true, like I know you won the World Series with the Red Sox in 2004, that you really didn't want to leave Boston? I mean, it was you, that was, those are your guys, that was your team. You broke the curse. Was it hard move to go to Cincinnati at the beginning?
Oh, that was the hardest pill I've ever had to swallow in my life, period. I mean, talk about like high school breakups with the girlfriends and whatever else is going on in your life. For me to sign a 3-year undervalued deal, we just won a World Series. You know, you've been grinding in the game already for a decade at this point. And I we get over the hump and you feel like you're at the top of the food chain, and you're playing in ESPN every single night in that rivalry against the Yankees. And you just felt like I wanted to do that for a few more years. Fenway Park is just unbelievably special. And then they just out of the blue hit me with, I'm being traded to the Cincinnati Reds. And at the time, I didn't know much about Cincinnati at all. I'd come here as a visiting player with the Pirates. And the only thing I really knew about the downtown felt like a little scarce, to be honest. It felt like there was not a lot of shops open. It felt like a deserted town. It felt like the old stadium was kind of weathered and there was, you know, leaks in the pipes and stuff. And it just didn't feel like a place you'd want to be in. But since I've gotten here, you know, they've revamped the city completely. The new ballpark at Great American obviously is a lot better than the old one. And, you know, they've they've made this feel like home for me. I realized over a short amount of time that, you know, it took me about a half a year to get used to it, but I really have grown to love this town. It's a little smaller than Boston. It's not so congested. And it's kind of a little bit more my speed coming from a small town, as you know, like Brooksville.
Yeah. You know what? We mentioned before the show, I can't remember what I did 5 minutes ago, but I can remember the Big Red Machine back in the 70s, the whole starting lineup, Johnny Bench, Tony Perez, Joe Morgan, Dave Concepcion, Pete Rose, Cesar Geronimo, Ken Griffey, George Forster. Just like that, I can rattle them off. You mentioned Joe Morgan a couple of times. What was it about Joe Morgan that you connected with?
You know, Joe was a great guy to tell stories. You know, he would be in the clubhouse a lot, probably more than any of the other guys. And he was just, you know, very humble in a way. He's quiet, but he always kind of would tell the truth, right? You didn't have to like dig a story out of him, but you also didn't feel like you were talking to somebody who was felt like he was too good for you. And so he told me just a lot of stories about him and Pete, because they ate lunch and breakfast together every single day. Back in those days, baseball was a little different, where you didn't have all the amenities at the ballpark. And so these guys spent a lot more time together away from the field than we do these days. And, you know, Joe just was somebody who made me feel like I could sit there all day and listen for an hour and tell me these stories from the 70s and just give you that old nostalgic feel of what it was like to be a Major League Baseball player at that time. And, you know, they're playing in New York sometimes, and you know, they're going to the same clubs with guys like Frank Sinatra and the Rat Pack back in then. And it almost feels like a time that doesn't exist anymore, and feels like a space that I never would have been in. If I'm hanging out with Brad Pitt, it still doesn't feel like, you know, Johnny Bench hanging out with Frank Sinatra, I don't think, or at least in my mind, it doesn't. Right. It's just cool to hear those stories.
Right, right. And we just saw a picture of you and Pete Rose. So I got to ask this. I'm sure you get asked this all the time. All-time hits leader. He's not in the Hall of Fame. Should he be?
Oh, man, of course. He's one of the greatest ball players of all time. And when you really look at his skill set, I mean, I used to think as a kid that Pete Rose was like an Albert Pujols, or like a real monster of the game. And he just wasn't. He was a guy who was undersized and really just accomplished all those numbers out of pure consistency, which is what I did. You know, I towed the rubber for 19 and a half seasons from the time I was drafted as an 18-year-old kid out of high school until I was 37 without missing a start. And Pete, you know, he put up 200 hits for something like, you know, 22 straight seasons or something. And to be able to do that, you know, with a guy who was not gifted as much as a lot of other players out there, is just absolutely remarkable.
Now, you played talk about Johnny Bench. I'm just going to throw out a name. Just what's the first thing that comes to mind about Johnny Bench?
You know, since I've known him, I didn't get to see him as a player, but just a showman. That, you know, he's a guy who can give you a great speech, he can tell you a joke, and he can sing a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What about Dave Concepcion, somebody that kind of goes under the radar with all those other superstars?
Yeah, you know, there's two or three guys on that team that I would just consider to be, you know, quiet guys. You know, Dave Concepcion is kind of a quiet guy. He flew under the radar, was just a really, really great player, but didn't have to be the flashiest guy on the field.
That's right. And we'll just pick another. George Forster. You get any time to spend with George Forster over the years?
Yeah, George has been around a lot. George, I would say George is probably the closest thing to like a Manny Ramirez personality-wise on this club. He's probably the quirkiest guy on the team. He's a jokester. He's always, you know, like, you know, he's been around me tons and tons of times, and he saw me from a distance the other day before we went into the gala for the induction, and he said, "Oh, look, that's Bronson Arroyo," and he said, "How tall is he?" And it's always a joke. It's like a shtick with him, and he's got like this this way about him that if you're around him, you know that he's not serious that often.
That's funny. Well, let's go back to that Saturday afternoon when you were inducted. We have a little clip to show our viewers out there. Let's check it out.
Right, welcome to the team. Exactly, I know my right knee hurts right now, but you know, it's just a joy to be here. I had no idea when I came to Cincinnati that I'd have the opportunity to play here long enough to even amass, you know, any kind of numbers to get into anybody's Hall of Fame. So to be in this one, it makes me feel good. It feels like home. I live here. I married somebody from this town, and thanks for having me.
But I am very grateful.
And talk about the other guys that got in, Graves and Gabe Paul.
Yeah, you know, Gabe Paul was it was kind of a learning experience for myself. Obviously, you know, being back way back in the day in the 40s, the 50s, and the 60s, Gabe Paul was this legendary guy of the game. I didn't realize he was the first one to sign Pete Rose to a minor league contract for $400 a month. You know, he also put a lot of the Big Red Machine together. He he has a lot to do with just things that have happened and are still happening at the major league level in baseball in general. He was almost like a pioneer, and I didn't know that history about him. I had a great conversation with his family about him. And obviously, Danny Graves was a player who played in Cincinnati for a long time. I played against him when I was with the Pirates. We didn't get to play together. We kind of just missed each other by a year, I believe. But Danny was a guy who was a little undersized as well. And you know, he was called the babyface assassin for a reason, because he was always clean shaven. Didn't look like a guy who could really close out baseball games, because we were so used to having kind of the, you know, the Rob Dibble types and the nasty boys from the 90s, and or somebody like a Goose Gossage, who you just think of this real kind of physical presence on the mound to close out baseball games. But Danny did it in a different way. He did it kind of subtly and quiet. And, you know, he's amassed some numbers there himself. So it was pretty cool to have him with me.
You know, growing up in New York and as a Yankee fan, Gabe Paul was the mastermind behind those 70 teams, all those trades and free agent signings. And you almost forgot the work that he did with other teams, Cincinnati. So it reminded me of how amazing that guy was. And to see his family on the field was a real honor, because he's passed on a number of years ago. But to honor them in Cincinnati, I think the ceremony was great. I know the Reds got swept this weekend, but the ceremony and everything around it was great. What do you think of the current Reds team now?
You know, they've been really exciting this year. Everybody had written them off before the season started, thinking that they were going to lose at least 100 games. You know, they start 7-15. It looks like it's kind of par for the course. And then these guys come up from AAA, a bunch of young guys like De La Cruz and Matt McClain, and these guys have really just shocked the city. Honestly, they've turned things around, and they've made people believe again. And they're doing it without starting pitching that, or really pitching in general, is not on the top of their game right now. They've done it with defense, speed on the bases, and offense, and that is something that the Reds haven't had in, you know, 20 years probably. So it's going to be really exciting to see the second half of the season and see if they can try to win the division championship. If they do that, it's you know, to me, it's going to be probably one of the great seasons of the last 20 years for the Cincinnati Reds.
Yeah. Now you spent some time in Arizona too. How was that in Arizona for you?
You know, Arizona was a kind of a different place. You felt like that Arizona Diamondbacks team and the management there, they do a better job in the community than any other team I've ever been around. They really care about their fans. They want their players to sign autographs. They want their players out in the community doing things for the community and with the community. It always felt, though, like a place in my mind where all the fans were, it was their second favorite team. So it was like I moved to Arizona as a Yankee fan, and now I live here, so Arizona is my second favorite team, right? And so you lose a little bit of that fever pitch, that real true third generation kind of like, I love this ball club, and I'll, you know, I'll cut off one of my fingers for them to win a World Series. You don't quite get that fever pitch, but you know, in the community, I think that organization does a fantastic job from front office all the way down, their medical staff, everybody there. Was a real joy to be a part of that.
Now, you won 148 games as a pro. That leg kick of yours, did you always have that when you were younger, or is that something you developed over time?
That was almost there from the beginning. That was 1984-85, Dwight Gooden, masterful pitcher for the New York Mets. That was what my childhood mind had morphed out of his mechanics. And so as time went on, I realized that I was using my foot as kind of a pendulum to flip my leg up. And it was very effortless for me. And it just became something that was part of the rhythm of the way that I would kind of approach the game. And you're trying to conserve energy out there on the mound. Can you get deep in the ball game? And you're trying to get outs with less. And all of that played a part in that. And the leg kick was just something that didn't feel so unique to me until you watched everybody else. But, you know, it's something that became a signature for me.
Did pitching coaches along the way support that, or did they try to tinker with that?
In the early years, they definitely tried to tinker with it in the minor leagues a little bit. But once they realized that I could stay on balance and that I could throw strikes, you know, those are the two main most important things as being a pitcher is, can you throw strikes and does your arm hurt? If your arm doesn't hurt and you can throw strikes, then you're kind of ahead of the game right there. And I could do that with that high leg kick and kind of stay on balance. And so after about high A, I'd say that it kind of left me alone. And I never had anybody at the big league level try to take it away from me.
Wow. And what do you think about pitching today? I mean, everything's changed in baseball. You know, you got the man on second and extra innings and the pitch count, the time clock. And, you know, starters don't go too many innings anymore. They're not workhorses like yourself and other pitchers in your era and before. Do you think pitching has changed? And do you think we should try to get back to starters going a little longer in games?
Yeah, you know, for me personally, I you always have these ebbs and flows in sports, and I in my mind, it's almost like a trend. That's the way I feel about it. You know, it's like, you know, baggy jeans are in right now, and then we have skinny jeans 5 years later. And in baseball, you've seen, you know, talking about hitting up on the ball to hit home runs, and you've seen the fact that starting pitching isn't going deep in a ball game because we have six guys in the bullpen that can all throw 95 plus. I really believe the best teams in the game still have three starters that can go deep in the game. And if you look at the best pitchers in the game, they're not throwing 95 to 100. Usually they're throwing like 93, 94, 92, 94, guys like Kershaw, guys like Zach Greinke, Max Scherzer, you know, gets it up a little bit higher than that. But these guys have versatility. And there's a lot of guys on the game that can go 95 to 100, but they only have two pitches. And their command suffers a little bit for it. And I don't know how long that they can do that without breaking down as well. So I feel like the pendulum has already swung back in the home run department. You see what the Reds are doing this year. You're seeing a little bit more small ball. You're seeing guys play the game a little bit old school. And I believe that the starting pitching is going to do the same thing. That being said, there's always going to be more guys that are more dominant in the bullpen now than they ever were in the 70s or the 80s. And I still think the bullpen is going to play a bigger role than they ever have. But I think the teams that win a World Series are going to have guys who can get into the seventh inning most nights.
We're getting people with some questions for you. Weight training for the pros, but also for women. What's your perspective on that?
I think the earlier, the better, honestly. You know, sometimes it's not always about just the strength of the training. Sometimes it's about movement patterns. If you show a young kid how to squat properly, you're also teaching them footwork. You're teaching them body control. You're teaching them, you know, the same way if you play soccer, you're obviously learning to use your feet in a way that will help you on the basketball court or on a baseball field. And so for me, you know, weight training, it doesn't always have to be heavy, but if you learn some of those movement patterns early on, you expand the mind, you turn the brain on, you help your coordination, and all those things can help athletes from front to back. So I love weight training and trying to just learn more and more things about your body and experimenting with yourself and see what works for you and what doesn't work for you. So when you get later in life and maybe you're playing college sports, you kind of know when you go into that weight room what you want to do and what you don't want to do to make yourself feel good.
And the caller earlier, Tina from the Florida Bulls, mentioned a chef. Have you had a personal chef throughout your career?
No, when I was playing ball, you know, down at the stadium, they always had chefs, but my guy, Timmy, he worked for the Reds for about a decade, and that's how I knew him for all these years. And he was kind of getting to the point where, you know, you're cooking 1,000 meals a day in spring training for guys. It can be tiresome. You're waking up at 4 a.m. and you're going to sleep at 11 o'clock at night, and you turn it right back around again. And you do that year round sometimes in baseball, and it can be a grind. And so I was looking for somebody to kind of make me feel like I could have 6 or 8 or 10 or 20 people like were in town for my induction. And to have food around, and it feels like an occasion a lot of times. It makes things go really smooth. It makes you feel like you're having a really good time enjoying company that's around you instead of worrying about how everybody's going to get fed. And you know, it's been one of the best things I've ever done in my life, I think. He's probably going to be with me from now until he doesn't want to work anymore.
Well, a couple of more things, and I want to I know it's I appreciate the great time you're spending with us. A lot of people are interested in you and want to congratulate you. How important is family for you? Because I saw that your wife was there in the stands and daughter. How important is that for you?
You know, I think, you know, family is probably super important, if not the most important thing for most people in their lives. And you know, I my whole speech, honestly, at the hall was a little different. It was kind of a strange angle. You know, most guys go up there and they usually speak about teammates and organization and how their career went. And I just wanted to be laser focused talking about my mother and my father and my sister, how I grew up inside of that house, how I was put in the weight room as a 6 and 7 year old kid, and all the philosophy of life that my father kind of beat into my head as we're having these conversations in between sets. And it was kind of like a love letter to my parents, you know? So obviously family is super important. I don't think I would have ever played, at the very most, I would have played college baseball if I didn't have a father who had really dedicated his life to making me a major league baseball player. And so, you know, if I was one of those guys who just had pure talent and I never saw my parents and they never came to my games and I just became a big leaguer on my own merit, then maybe it wouldn't have felt so important. But I know for sure that without those early years with my father in that weight room from age 6 to 18, there's not a chance in the world that my little thin body would have held up in Major League Baseball.
Well, you know, I love how you ended the speech when you're on the field, because you said, if you see me in the supermarket or something like that, come up to me, say hi, I want to talk to you. You kind of embraced that dialogue with the community. I thought that was a cool way to end what you had to say on the field when you got inducted.
Yeah, when I was being inducted on the field, you know, it was too impersonal in a lot of ways, you know, to touch fans on a mass scale like that in a stadium of 40,000 people. It's very hard to be very intimate. And there's also an echo in the stadium that you don't quite realize on the microphone. And it's very distracting. And so I knew I wasn't going to be able to be real personal. I wasn't going to be able to talk about my family. But I wanted the community in Cincinnati to know that I had infiltrated their homes for 9 years through the television screen, doing interviews post-game and pre-game. And I know they have an idea of who I am as a person. And I wanted them to know that I feel the love in the community to this day when I'm going out playing music shows or if I'm doing something baseball related around town. And if people can come up and say hi, it's always a joy.
Wow. And before we end with music, because you're a musician too, a couple of questions have come our way. Who's the hardest hitter you faced?
Albert Pujols, without question. You know, he was a guy who just, I had to face him. You know, we had to play the Cardinals 19 times a year being in the division. And he was just as good as they're ever going to come in this game, period. He could cover both sides of the plate. He could put the ball in play. He didn't strike out much. He had a great eye, unbelievable power, could play hurt, you know, played every single day. I mean, he is the pinnacle of the game and always will be.
Wow. Best teammate?
Back in those 04 days, man, I'd say the guy who drove the clubhouse more than anybody, Kevin Millar, personality was just absolutely a joy to be around. He was a guy who, you know, who kind of, he wasn't even part of the union because he wound up being a replacement player as a minor leaguer for one day. And for a guy to be a replacement player, or what they used to call as a scab, these guys were almost shunned in the game at one time. And Kevin was still the leader in that clubhouse. And that's hard to do coming from that perspective. And I always have really loved his personality. And it's why he's gone on for Major League Baseball Network to do so many great things from his basement, you know, having the same show every day.
Yeah, it's great. MLB, definitely. Best manager?
You know, I've had a lot of good managers. I mean, Terry Francona was great with the Boston Red Sox, but just overall, man, Dusty Baker was a guy who just made you feel like he was really a player's manager. He made you feel like he was really pulling for you, not necessarily just pulling for the organization. He was personally pulling for you. He's the most eclectic man I've ever been around, leaves the most tickets for friends every night. He's bringing food for players who feel sick. He's sending flowers to people's wives or families if their parents have passed away. He just is a man who, across the board, is one of the most interesting men I've ever been around.
Best baseball experience?
You know, it's impossible to beat, man. It's impossible to beat Yankee Stadium, Fenway Park, or, you know, we obviously got it done in St. Louis, but winning that World Series in 04 was something, you know, 86 years in the making. I had seen 1986 and watched the Mets win that World Series, and playing for the Red Sox in 03, I got to feel the heartbreak in that town. And, you know, I knew that when we won that one, there would be no bigger high in the game that I would ever have than in that moment.
Did you ever meet Bill Buckner? Did you ever hang out with him? Because he got a rough deal in Boston, but then everybody's thankful that everybody came around before he passed. And, you know, he was a great hitter, a great person. Did you ever get to spend time with him?
I did not. You know, Buckner was still kind of in hiding up in Montana, I believe, for many, many years after that. And after 04, there was some whispers that maybe they'd get him to come back, and he still was kind of not ready. And then I think in 2007, when they won it again, he came back and they honored him in the field. And it was a beautiful thing to see, you know, just to be embraced again by the community, to also just realize what a great ball player he was, right? He is often stamped with this one label of this one play. And if you look at his career, it was an amazing career. And if that would have happened to me, you know, you give up one home run and just taint all your numbers as a big league player, it would be heartbreaking. And I was glad he got to come back and kind of resurrect that before he did pass.
Right. Real quick, growing up in Florida, what players did you look up to, baseball players?
You know, Ozzie Smith, the shortstop for the St. Louis Cardinals, I saw him do a backflip on TV when I was 6 and 7 years old. And that was my guy. I thought I'd be a big league shortstop. And also on the pitching side, Greg Maddux. He was, I think he's the greatest of all time. I don't think anybody will ever touch Greg Maddux. 355 wins, throwing sub 90 miles per hour. His numbers are absolutely remarkable.
Unbelievable. Now, you're a musician. You have a band, 04. You've been playing around all around the place. I know you probably play a lot in Cincinnati. So I got to ask you this question. What kind of musicians did you look up to when you were younger?
You know, that first album, 1991, 92, I'm a 15-year-old kid, Pearl Jam and Eddie Vedder. That thing knocked my socks off, the 10 album. And, you know, and then growing up in the weight room with my father all those years, you were listening to, you know, John Lennon and the Beatles. And it felt like something that even as a child, you could understand that there was something so magical about this music that it was going to last for eternity.
And when did you start playing and singing and performing at the same time you were coming up in the ranks with baseball? We might have lost Bronson there for a moment. Go ahead, Bronson.
Yeah, I started playing when I was 22. I was in the weight room, you know, with my father working out and listening to music all the time. But I never really thought I wanted to be a musician or play music. When I was 22, I was in AA with the Pirates. And I got an acoustic guitar. Somebody gave me one. And I just started kind of singing a little bit, hacking away at it. And I realized very quickly that it was something that was going to be life's work. It was going to take me past the game. And it was going to be something I could dig into and grind and have a good time and get some angst off the chest and just be a beautiful piece of art. And to this day, I know now that that's what I will be doing for the rest of my life, even if it's just sitting around a campfire and playing for friends.
That's great. Have you ever met Bernie Williams? Because he's kind of did the same thing.
Yeah, me and Bernie have played many shows together. Always a good time being with Bernie. He's kind of he's obviously more of a trained musician than I am, and we come from different angles. He's a jazz guitar player who just wants to stand on the side of the stage very quietly and kind of just play over every song. Just tell him what key you're in, and he can get it. And I'm the guy out front kind of singing loud, and it's kind of a juxtaposition. But, you know, musicians love musicians, and I always enjoy being around Bernie.
Well, that's great. You have your own band. Talk about your band and how can people get a hold of you?
If you want to see the original album, you know, it's Bronson Arroyo in the 04. I put an album out in February. You can find it anywhere that you find your music, on iTunes, Apple Music. You can also go to Amazon and order, you know, the vinyl records or CDs. And then, you know, if you happen to be in the Cincinnati area and you want to check out the Bronson Arroyo Band Facebook page, we play a lot of shows around here, mostly cover songs from the Beatles all the way to Nirvana. And that we probably play 15, 20 shows a year. And it's a good time. You know, we're playing somewhere between 200 people and a couple thousand people. You know, it depends on what venue you're playing. But we have a good time here.
Yeah. At the beginning of the show, we played one little clip of Nights Alive. We're going to end with Never Let You Go. Talk about those songs. And is it hard to put the songs lyrically and musically on paper and get it out there? Or is it easy for you?
No, it was always tough. You know, I feel I wasn't like a naturally born musician as many people. If you ever listen to an interview by Ed Sheeran, he'll tell you that he was terrible when he was 14, and by 18, he had written 18, which is a song that is absolutely stunning. And you know, it's just hard work. And I'm doing the same thing that I did as a young kid, baseball wise. I do musically now, and you kind of go in the woodshed and hash away at it. And writing songs is a whole nother level than performing. And so I finally figured out if I had a writing partner that I could try to get through the lyrical part of a song. And so, you know, all these songs I wrote in 2018, and the one you're gonna hear, Never Let You Go, is just the quietest, you know, prettiest song on the album. And I'm talking about John Lennon, Paul McCartney, Elvis Presley, and Bob Dylan in this song. And the chorus is just kind of a universal theme of, you know, love is all you need. And it's John Lennon wrote that. And it was also done in a song called Love Boat Captain by Pearl Jam. But I wanted to reiterate it again. It's like, we know these words have already been said, but it's never lost on me that, you know, love is pretty much the highest of highs we've got here on the planet. And so I wanted to write something in that vein.
Cincinnati Red Hall of Famer Bronson Arroyo, thank you very much, sir. God bless you. And thank you for giving us a shot of helping others. I really appreciate you, man.
All right, Steve. Have a good one, man. Thank you.
God bless. Bronson Arroyo, going to take us home with Never Let You Go.
Two stars are born just around the bend.